If you give me a few minutes, I want to explain how non-locality can also be topological of nature. But then I would have to explain something about black holes, if you allow me for a few minutes. Is that all right?
Yeah,
Sure.
please take off
Yeah, because
my.
if I can then share a screen for a moment.
Yeah. How do can you? How do I share?
Yes, I will stop yours.
Yeah. Can you? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I put mine in. I don't know whether you see this now. This is the universe outside a black hole, which is trivial. There are particles coming out from the past horizon, which is here. There's a future horizon, which is there. Particles go in. And the big question is, how can ingoing particles affect the outgoing particles? They do, according to all reasonable theories, but how can this happen? And the answer is you have to go to the complete Penrose diagram. Now, Penrose himself objected against this because he said there's no sign of the ingoing and outgoing matter. But what I claim is that you shouldn't, if you want to look at the black hole, how it is now, you should not include matter which came in there a million years ago or matter which leaves a million years from now. And that has to do with the topology. Now, I prepared a few pieces of paper. I don't know whether you can see this.
Erad, one question. Look,
Yes.
small question. This Penrose diagram is a picture of whole universe and which is eternal and there is no
Yes, and now you see two. So if you take this Penrose diagram, you actually see two universes. You see a region one, which is smoothly connected to region two. They both represent the black hole. This is a fundamental problem that has to be cured. And the cure is non is topological non-triviality. And I try to explain that. And
Sorry, so
I
I'm
started a piece
confused.
of paper. Sorry?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm a bit confused. So, like, you have black hole, right? So, and so you, when you say two regions,
Yes.
this is what has been confusing for me. When
It
these two universes.
certainly is. And if you give me a few minutes, I can explain what's going to happen
Okay.
there. Because
Okay.
it's very
Thanks.
important. And I've been running out. So here I have a piece of paper with a coordinate grid on it. And I'm going to do something that happens quite frequently. You cut out a region like this. And now you can glue these ends together. So now they're gluing together. I again have a space-time that's locally flat, but there's a cusp singularity here. Now, in two plus one dimensional gravity, this means there's a flat region of space-time here, and these cusps are the particles. That's a very interesting model for gravity in two plus one dimensions. Now, in two dimensions, I can do something else. I can look
So,
at the
Gerard,
component.
is this a, so is this a, so you are discussing an eternal black hole. So it's infinitely massive.
Now,
So it
I'm
must
on
be
my
infinite.
way explaining what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And the next step would be a conformal theory. This is a conformal set of coordinates. All these lines here are straight lines. So I can do the same thing as I did with the previous piece of paper. In conformal gravity, I'll fold this and I'll cut out a circle. So with my scissors, I cut out.
No, Gerard, before you cut out the circle, I have a basic question. So you said this black hole is eternal. So it has an
Yes.
infinite mass, therefore. So it's an
No,
infinitely
no.
massive.
Eternal black holes,
How is it an
well,
eternal
its
set?
mass is large compared to the Planck mass. Say 1,000 or more Planck masses or something like that, good enough. Its lifetime will be very, very long. That's
But
good enough.
not eternal. Not eternal, Gerard.
Well, it's an exponential, the lifetime is an exponential function of that, or it's a
No,
high power, sorry, not exponential, it's m to the
it's not
third.
exponential function, it's power law.
So m to the third
R2.
is such a long time that for all
Well, it's only
practical purposes.
R2, but black hole is not so long-lived, actually. Black hole lives at the time, which is R cubed divided by a Planck square. I mean, that's not a terribly long time.
Well, not well, it's long compared to the eigen frequency modes of the black hole. So what I've been doing now is I cut out this and I'm left over with this. Now, the claim is that what you can do here is you can do the same thing as I did with a flat piece of paper, glue the endpoints together. So now how to do that is not so easy. I draw here a circle, and I identify that at the opposite side, same way. So now these two red dots, which I have here, are to be identified. And I glue this thing onto itself with a 180 degree rotation around it, so that the points that glue together are always opposite to each other. That you could call the antipodal identification. So it means that with antipodal identification, you cut out a region of space-time and you take the remainder as being a compactified space-time. But you can also do something else. The thing you can also do is take this part and now invert this, because this is a conformal symmetry. So I can say that the center is actually infinite. And so when I invert that, I get another region of the same shape as this one. And now I can glue the two together and you get a space-time, which I also have here somewhere, let me see. Yes, now you get this, if you smoothen things out, you get this space-time, and then I can say, but now I can identify opposite points, and now I get this. See, this is the thing I talked about previously, which has opposite points here identified. Now, Penrose was worried that this generates a cusp singularity. But of course, when you look at this thing here, there's no cusp singularity at all. And if you identify opposite points, these points never come close. Only when these points would be at the same point, there would be a cusp singularity. But now there isn't. And this proposal, at first I thought when I saw this, this was totally crazy. And I've heard talks about this before, and I was just not listening how crazy this is, generating space-time. But actually, this is very healthy to do, because it replaces those two asymptotic regions I had before by one single one, effectively, because this sort of identifies with that one, but twisted to the antipodes. And that gives some extremely interesting non-trivial behavior. I put something, I made a brief description of that on my homepage in the form of a comic story of an investigator who steps over the horizon and goes through all sorts of adventures. If you go to my homepage and look in, you can easily Google to my homepage, and then you see at the beginning, there's a little essay about or a story about the Mr. Jones who crosses the horizon and has all sorts of adventures. And now you can see one of his adventures is that where he enters, time runs backwards. Because not only space is inverted here, time is inverted here as well. But with some hesitation, I would be leading to this kind of picture for a black hole, where you have now the same thing in four dimensions. By the way, you can also take the three-dimensional compactified space-time with this instanton-like thing. But now you can also do it in four dimensions. In four dimensions, this is an instanton. I hesitate a bit to show this picture because it's not quite right. It suggests things that are not really there. It suggests that you can cut out a little light cone here and glue it back together here. But somehow these points are being identified. That's a more accurate way of saying that the two circles and the two arrows, they identify. So this way, again, you compactify things, but these points are far separated. But for a black hole on the horizon, time is standing still. So these two points are actually at the same time physically. That makes the picture a bit difficult to understand. But this generates an instanton, and one can think of the whole black hole being a four-dimensional instanton this way. And at first sight, you might say that now I'm totally crazy and this is no longer serious physics. But if I look again at this thing and I go back, where was it?
Erhard?
Yes.
Could you explain how would you form it dynamically? Like the regular black hole,
important question indeed. But
and I don't think it's possible this to form it.
Somehow this seems to answer that question, that the dynamics happens here with an infinitesimal instanton. Now, instantons are really quantum, have quantum effects. Classically, an instanton does nothing. But the quantum mechanical thing, this instanton can generate tunneling from the previous situation to the new situation. So the instanton tells you how the tunneling goes, actually, by identifying opposite points. So this gives me a regular piece of space-time, but it is the ingoing matter which makes, must form a black hole to, you know, to begin, to cause this instanton to happen in the first place. It's like an interaction, as you also see in the four-dimensional instantons in QCD, where it raises the mass of a particle. That's where you have to think about an instanton. So you can think of virtual black holes. The very, very tiny ones form and disappear very quickly. So their lifetime is indeed finite, like m to the third. But that instanton with a lifetime of m to the third is indeed the thing that I think it was Gia complaining about, the lost short lifetime. That's just the thing which forms and decays immediately after. And you can think of such virtual events to fill all of space-time. And that would totally change our view of space and time. That would make space-time like foam of some sort. And you know, foam in space-time has been a popular idea for some time ago. Maybe we have to look at things this way, or maybe this foam formation could be a way for nature to discretize. So there are all sorts of possibilities of this sort that I think are very interesting and promising. But of course, again, as he also explained yesterday, it's very hard to ask the right questions in the right order and trying to answer them. But this, what I'm suggesting now is that this generates topology in space-time. For instance, if you look at this thing and you think of this world to be inhabited by living creatures. I'll draw a living creature here for a moment. This is a living creature, and the living creature has a heart, and the heart is at its left. So the heart is here. And I'll draw a living creature with a heart, and the heart's at the left-hand side of the body. Now, I let this creature cross the horizon, and he emerges at the other side, but he emerges at the other side with his heart at the other side. So this thing does the same thing as our Zoom communication system, because it shows yourself in mirror image, but not the other participants. And I wanted to illustrate that, but it's very rather hard to show. But if you show your right hand, if everybody shows his right hand, you see it yourself, seem to be showing your left hand. So there's the Zoom viewer does something nasty with left and right. But this does the same thing. The observer going in, when he comes out, he finds his heart to be at the other side. So if you look at the living creatures in this universe, you see half of the creatures have the heart at the right-hand side, the other half have the heart at the left-hand side. So you can distinguish them how many times they went through this black hole. And even times, your heart's at the left, an odd number of times your heart's at the right. So our physical, the black holes that we believe in our universe are like that, except that quantum mechanics, it happens only quantum mechanically. So the quantum tunneling processes from one region to the other are like that they put your heart at the other side of your body. Now,
maybe Gia wants to say.
Yes.
I want to ask one question to Gerhard.
Yes.
So I want just very simple question. Suppose the question which we were discussing before also. Suppose you take electron and positron, you collide them in high energy. So we know at least in GR, in the normal case, Penrose has taught us how the apparent horizon forms and how the things settle to event horizon. So exactly what happens in this in your picture then? How would I imagine that my Alice and Bob, when they come sufficiently close to each other, how do I really form a trap surface in this case?
Well, most of this happens classically. And my model of the black hole actually is a system that it doesn't want to move anymore. So what I want to show, argue, is that it's very important that these two regions, which seem to be disconnected or connected by a wormhole, are actually interacting very strongly. And the strong interaction comes from the gravitational effect that in particles have on out particles.
So you need some topological changing process. With GI, yes, cannot
you need this topology because the ingoing particles have effect on the outgoing particles by moving them about. So by gravitational forces, a particle can move from one domain to the other domain, and that generates an interaction. So if you try to not to listen to me, but you say you ignore that there is such a topological effect by disconnecting these two regions, that won't help. It will bring you into trouble because particles are being moved around by the gravitational effects of other particles, by the fact that the background is only flat as long as you have light particles, but particles which fall to horizons become very energetic. And then their gravitational force causes these extra interactions, which you can calculate. It's all perturbative gravity on in curved background, and we can handle such calculations. So you can calculate these things. I'm not just making it up, but these have been backed up by explicit calculations, which, by the way, also give you the black hole microstates and everything in a quite reasonable way. Not in a perfect way. I still have many questions which I don't know how to answer. But I think this is a very promising road. It tells you that black holes actually might induce interactions. Those interactions will have some sense of non-locality to them because the black hole is formed here, decays somewhere else, and does the same thing as GS particles, massive graviton, but then that massive graviton is the role of that is replaced by a very light black hole, which can do similar things.
Just to understand the terminology, you, in the beginning, you said identification. What is precisely identification physically means? I want to get fully understand clearly. So identification.
Same thing as this, what I did here was I was making an instanton, or rather, I was giving a topological twist to the space-time, but it's next to a local phenomenon because globally it's just a small region space-time where you glue these things together in a curved way so that it looks like an object, like a soliton actually, a soliton in two space, but you can have the soliton in any number of spaces. And then the black hole is the space-time soliton, which we call instanton, that tells you the thing actually is an event in space and time. So it gets formed, it does something and it decays again. All that is basically, it is normal physics in Euclidean space, which becomes quantum physics in Minkowski space-time, or in Minkowski metric space-time. So that the interaction is a completely quantum mechanical effect. But the way we can compute the quantum mechanical effect is very similar as in the instanton. We take that background and we do perturbative field theory on that background. So the same thing I do with the black hole. I take these topologically non-trivial configurations. Everything else is perturbation expansion, except the gravitational interaction between particles that went in long ago and particles that go out in the distant future. They have an infinitely divergent gravitational effect onto one another. That effect is so big that it changes everything. And if you forget to compute what that does, you get a completely wrong image of what a black hole actually does. So this is why I believe that many people do not really understand what black holes are doing because they didn't do this calculation of this, what I call Shapiro effect, which is the effect, the dragging effect. What a particle going in drags the other particles to get out. As a consequence of this dragging effect, you can actually identify the ingoing particles by looking at the outgoing particles. And this is an S matrix amplitude, which turns the entire black hole into an S matrix event, not fundamentally different from any other S matrix event in ordinary physics. So in ordinary physics, we have collision of two particles. They do something and they make an S matrix and get out again. The black hole now does exactly the same thing. It has lost its status.
Okay, I think we can ask Gerbia now. Ask
Gerhard, in his case, in your case, you would require large scale violation of causality. So the
Well, I said no. Listen, I was lying. But there seems to be violation of causality, but only if you go beyond the original domain of the calculation. Originally, I was considering particles in this space-time. These particles obey local physical laws, so nothing is acausal, except that now the ingoing particles leave their effect on the outgoing particles, which looks like a non-local effect, but it isn't really, because it is all calculated by local physics. And if you take a space-time, but you glue these ends together like I did here, that doesn't make the theory non-local. It just gives you a soliton-like structure. You may call a soliton a non-local thing, like the magnetic monopole in gauge theories. That's not really true. It's just the boundary conditions, which are topologically non-trivial, but everything else is completely local. But if you don't know what you're doing, it looks like a non-local effect. That's true.
Okay. So I also have a basic question. Maybe we can give word to Gia now. Was it?
So Gerhard, I was trying to understand the how could I understand what you are saying from my perspective? Because as I said several times, and also I mentioned in my talk, so we are doing completely straightforward asymmetric computation in the kinematic regime that is fully under control. Let's assume that we the two groups with two different methods each or whatever, there is no mistake and we see exactly the same thing.
Kind of theory are you using? String theory or not?
We did the consistency. So we did computation within gravity, quantum gravity, with ordinary interactions of gravitons. The computation is fully non-perturbative, so it's not an artifact of the perturbation theory. And then as a cross check, we did the same computation in string theory. So in other words, let me just use this as a, so we can come back to this and question this, but I don't think the issue is in the computation. So this computation.
One issue is that you should take into account the back reaction, the gravitational interaction between in and outgoing particles. So I'm not doing any different from what you're saying. So that in and outgoing particles interact, because that interaction is fundamentally divergent.
No,
so badly divergent that you have to redefine what the particle is.
Yeah, let me tell you what I know, and then we'll see. Maybe you will tell me some, that there is something wrong. What I'm saying is that in a fully fledged asymmetric computation in which you do collide two Transplanckian energy particles, we see that in the kinematic regime, which is fully under control, we can go into technical details. Let's not do that now. We see the following: that we see that these two gravitons, they classicalize, they soften into large number of soft gravitons, which precisely saturates the unitarity at the point of the black hole entropy. So it's exactly the same. So we see that we are forming an object with which consists of bunch of soft gravitons and decay, and then they decay into bunch of soft gravitons with the entropy exactly black hole entropy. Okay, so now.
Do you call that thing that you create a black hole or not?
Sorry?
Do you call that thing that you create a black hole or don't you?
What else should I call it? I mean, tell me what to call it and I'll call it something else.
Well, for instance, a black hole is just a locally flat space-time which only has Hawking-like particles around it. Why do you need more particles? You can create it. Then it will probably live for some time like a black hole. But no, I'm asking you about that black hole that you create, whatever it is that you created.
Sure.
How does it evolve in time?
Sure. So in other words, look, there are several ways in which you can approach this, right? So first, number one, first step is that you do asymmetric computation. And in asymmetric computation, you see that there is a resonance produced that decays into precisely the same number of quanta that Hawking would predict, precisely of the same softness, and entropy, which precisely matches Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of a black hole. This is what you see from the S-matrix. Now, then, of course, as a next step, you can develop theory of this resonance and see whether this multi-graviton state really saturates, is a saturon, it saturates unitarity at 1/alpha, whether it behaves. And every evidence we see for, of this object, this has been studied in, from many different points of view. We see that this object behaves like a black hole. But my question, my point is not about that. I mean, there is no question by now that the S matrix predicts that there is a resonance produced with the entropy that matches black hole entropy, which decays into Hawking-like spectrum of quanta, and which with every property we see matches the black hole property. No, well, the question is not that. I'm not questioning that. I want to reconcile that with what you are saying, okay? Because in that S matrix computation, I don't see any evidence that the bridge, while this happens, any bridge is established with a different part of the universe.
Exactly. Also, but right. I'm saying the same thing, that there is no bridge. There is no bridge to another universe.
So whatever construction you are doing.
It just goes between the two hemispheres of the same black hole. So
the black hole is understanding is right. More so like my understanding would be that what you are doing is correct. My understanding would be that what you are doing is correct, but it's a special construction in which you are dressing some sort of a wormhole, or I don't know what, I have to study it in more details. Some topological construction which you are dressing by a horizon, and so it's sort of a black hole, but it is more than an ordinary black hole, because for an ordinary black hole which has no input topological structure in which I can produce on in S matrix, I don't see anything like that. So I think
ordinary black hole is a
more special object than an ordinary S matrix black hole. That's my understanding.
Ordinary black hole, you would not be able to identify its energy eigenmorphs. So you talk about the S matrix.
I'm able
to
identify
within the S matrix.
No,
before
I
you said you should find.
We are identifying things within theories. We cannot identify things abstractly, right? You have your theory. You are giving me
but
this, and I have.
That's the advantage of the picture that I'm generating. That the calculation you say produces the S matrix. That's a calculation of an infinite amount of time. I'm not that clever. I just want to ask to calculate first what happens over an infinitesimal amount of time. So I have a small time step.
Sure.
I want to understand how the degrees of freedom of this thing evolve over a small time step. And then I can integrate to as large times as I want and reproduce an S matrix.
I fully accept the computation. These are not inter-exclusive, I'm saying. S matrix gives me first approximation. S matrix tells me, look here, there is some resonance there. S matrix tells me this evidence. S matrix gives me evidence that there is a resonance with properties which are extremely similar, strikingly similar to a black hole. Because
something
the entropy
is missing. Something is missing in what you tell me. And if I take ordinary particle physics or ordinary atomic physics, I have two atoms which collide and they generate an S matrix, then I want to know what kind of physical laws do you use? In the case of the atom, you know what happens locally. So you have a local theory telling you how these atoms interact, and they do all sorts of things. They exchange electrons and God knows what, and photons, and then finally everything goes out again. The collision has been completed, and that's an S matrix. Now, for the atom, what happened during the collision was only a very, very short amount of time. The time that an electron needs to hop from one nucleus to the other or something like that. That's about the time it takes for an atom to collide. For a black hole, this is different. The collision takes thousands of billions of years. Because
I can answer.
In, make a black hole, it takes billions of years for the black hole to do all sorts of things, and then finally it evaporates. So that's a hell of a complicated thing. If you don't know what happens locally, I can't understand what your calculation means.
No,
you answer Gia and then Irina, okay.
I can answer this. I'm saying, look, there's not this language, I can answer this. What I see is the following thing, that this process of 2-to-n graviton scattering is dominated by the momentum transfer given by the inverse of what would be a Schwarzschild radius of a black hole. That's a fact. So this is what computation.
Yeah, beautiful, yeah, but what kind of physics did you put in?
Einsteinian vertex is a theory, S matrix theory of a spin 2 particle obtained as a low energy theory of string theory.
If you take if you took Einstein's equations, you have to generate, whether you like it or not, two horizons, a past horizon, a future event horizon. But it was in there, came from there. Well, how did they, were they processed during that event? You have to tell me how this particle, what happened to this particle before it communicated.
Sure, we cannot compare apples with oranges. I mean, in the S-matrix computation, I can only do S-matrix computation. I cannot solve Einstein's equations by S-matrix computation.
Both calculations are right, yeah, there should be a mapping from one calculation to the other. There should be no doubt about that. Giving otherwise, one of them is wrong.
I'm giving you mapping. What else can I give you? I'm saying that the object, the resonance that I see as a result of an S-matrix computation has entropy, which matches black hole entropy. It has
softness. The calculation, but you didn't tell me what you put in the calculation. What went in? What kind of physics was it?
The computation is done as a scattering computation in a low energy theory or string theory, whatever low energy theory or string theory gives
me. This string theory you talk about.
Low energy theory or string theory gives me Einstein gravity with Einsteinian vertices. I can compute that, and this, as a consistency check, we did computation in a fully fledged string theory, and the answers are identical up to 1/n. That's natural because low energy theory of string theory is Einstein gravity. So therefore, it's natural that when momentum transfer in your process is much less than the string scale, string theory reproduces Einsteinian gravity. That's the coupling. That's so what you would expect.
I'm talking about large black holes, so that this space and time scale I'm using is small even compared to string theory. I don't care about string theory. I only care about standard model kind of physics. Or to be more precise, all I care about is what's the momentum distribution of matter going in, what's the momentum distribution of matter going out.
Let's give a word to Irina maybe, because she raised her hand. I think she wants to say something related to this topic.
Okay, I would like to ask you, how was Hawking radiation in your geometry? So if you take a black hole with a amplification, what happens with usual Hawking radiation? And in other words, what is the temperature of your construction?
Very good question. The configuration that I would call empty, which is that Penrose diagram without any particles in, for the local observer that would be a vacuum. Actually, in my case, it's something more complicated. It's not really the vacuum state, but it's a state where particles in and particles out are in their lowest state. And that is, of course, Hawking's vacuum, so that when there's no particles as seen by a local observer, there are particles for a distant observer, which are the Hawking particles. So the Hawking particles come out like that. Actually, it gets a little bit more complicated because the Hawking particles at the two hemispheres are entangled. So what you always thought to be a thermal state isn't a thermal state anymore, because the states at one side of at one hemisphere of the black hole are entangled with the states at the other side of the black hole. Now, if you look with a telescope at the black hole, you only see one hemisphere. So you don't see any of the strange correlations that these particles have with the other side, the other hemisphere, but it does. So if you look at the black hole from one angle, you see perfect thermal behavior. But that's because you can't see the other side. If you see both sides, you find that the entanglement violates the thermal correlation functions, but enhances the correlation functions when heavy particles are coming out of both sides. So it's no longer a completely thermal, but only if you look from one direction, then it looks thermal.
Maybe Francesco raised his hand before. I don't know if Irina, you want to answer or we can go further. Okay, then Francesco, you had you want to ask a question before, right?
Yeah, so no, I'm just trying to understand exactly the picture, because so in your Penrose diagram, for instance, you also draw the interior region, the two actually with the singularities, right? The past and the future singularity.
Yes.
But then you tell me that you identify points on the horizons, the past and the future horizon. So that interior region is not your manifold, or am I wrong?
Well, these two regions are also there, but they're also identified. So the regions are called 3 and 4. Somehow, yeah, my file is now removed again, so now you can't see it. But I had regions 3 and 4. They are also now identical. Region 3 is the antipodal identification of region 4. So they are also now related. They must be, because otherwise you are counting too many states. You see, the problem I was having was state counting. I don't believe that the general coordinate transformation is correct if it maps a state, one point of one universe is mapped into two points in the other universe. That's what happens with Penrose's eternal diagram, that eternal black hole diagram, that one point on that diagram represents two points, or rather converse. One point of our universe is represented by two points on that diagram. And that's a one-to-two mapping, which you can't tolerate in quantum mechanics. So the quantum particles have to choose where they are. So if you identify those points, now you can do, then you can do quantum mechanics on this space-time and compare amplitudes one by one from one to the other observation.
I would say that this problem arises just because the eternal black hole is not a physical space-time. Because when you have a gravitational collapse, you don't produce that space-time. But because the problem that I have with this picture, if I understand it correctly, because probably I just don't understand it, is that you cannot go into the trapped region because you cannot go in the trapped region. It's an exception.
I have no business to do with the trapped region. So the Cauchy surface always stays away from the trapped region or penetrates only infinitesimally.
Yeah, the Cauchy surface is back.
The Cauchy surface pivots around the origin like this. That's how the Cauchy surface does. So it never has to go very far into these two trapped regions.
Yeah, but so then
so that
that region is not part of your space time. So
exactly. So that all points on the Cauchy surface are visible from the outside world, so that I have a one-to-one mapping now with things seen by outside observer and things seen by the inside observer. So now I can do this mapping, and now I can map states onto states and just ask myself what happens when I do this mapping. And a lot more interesting things happen. I have no time to explain it all now to you. So there are lots of interesting things happening. But the bottom line is now you can calculate everything, because now all the physical states of this particular configuration are mapped into physical space that you are quite familiar with when we do ordinary quantum field theory on ordinary, moderately curved space-time, where we understand what we are doing. Because locally, it's all ordinary physics.
Yeah, but I don't understand how this object could form. Like, I think Anupam was going in this direction.
Well, because the one thing I have to assume, and that's a problem for me as well, of course, is that during one very, very small fraction of time and space, an instanton must have occurred.
But what about the
topology into another topology? But that is a very, very local effect, too small even to be understood by particle physics. So nothing spectacular happens there, just an instanton.
But from this moment on, you can use this
new coordinate frame. You see it grow by particles going in, but not escaping fast enough to get out. So the thing becomes heavy, because it has been eating so many particles and not excreting enough particles, so you get heavier when you do that. And that's quite normal physics. So the black hole grows, and then gradually it shrinks again by emitting particles. And that's the normal affair that takes place. So I cannot completely answer your question, but I can make it a very small question. The very small question is, what happened at this infinitesimal point when the horizon was opening up?
Okay, but this
the answer is, I have to go from one coordinate frame to another coordinate frame in order to proceed my calculation.
Mm-hmm.
And this happens quite normally.
What's the correction to thermality in your picture?
Sorry?
What's the correction to Hawking spectrum? There must be some correction to Hawking's exact thermal spectrum.
Well,
so what's the
correction? I mentioned the main correction. The main correction is that it's no longer a thermal state. It's now a pure state. And the pure state has particles at the opposite side of the black hole, not identified, but being entangled. So
the amount
are entangled with antiprotons coming at the out from the other side.
So what's the amount? So in Hawking picture, there is Hawking, which is derived for eternal black hole, but basically Hawking computation. There we have exact thermality in the spectrum. Now, any physical...
if you don't identify the opposite points, it's completely thermal. But the problem with thermal, of course, is that we don't understand the quantum pure states.
Right, right. But Gerald, but the point is the following, that you don't need to go even to any quantum theory or macroscopic theory. You can see it. We had this debate, remember, several years ago.
Yes.
Right. So you don't need... So you can take two Hawking's equations. One is his relation between temperature and the radius, and another, his Stefan Boltzmann law. And his two of the Hawking relations immediately tell you that as soon as the black hole mass is finite, the deviations from thermality go as one divided by black hole entropy.
Yeah.
So this is exactly what S-matrix computation gives us. But in your picture, do you capture this correction? The one over black hole entropy to thermality or no?
I find that correction difficult to make. So I haven't done that calculation.
Okay.
Because there are problems which have to come first, which is that the microstate counting works, but not perfectly. So I still have a problem with the cutoff there. The cutoff is at large L values where you see no physical effects. So physics, the physics that you see only comes from low L Hawking radiation. In fact, it was you who pointed out to me at some time that Hawking radiation is mainly concentrated on low L values, which I hadn't realized at that moment, but you are perfectly right. But it also means that having a cutoff for large L has no physically observable effect.
But a little, very little.
The cutoff does tell you how many states there are.
Yes, I agree.
And for this reason, I find it difficult to calculate this.
No, with that, I agree fully. Yeah, I agree. With that, I agree, but yeah.
The thing I do get is a perfect characterization of the microstates. So the microstates are energy eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, and I can exactly follow a plane wave of particles going in and a plane wave of particles getting out due to this thing going in. So the thing going in stimulates the particle to go out in the same plane wave, or a spherical wave, I should say. With plane and time. And so this is an exact calculation that one can do. And all I see other people who do calculations like you do, they say that the microstates are chaotic. I don't know what chaotic means in this.
In our picture. We can also predict microstate frequencies and actually the
I would like to ask you then, if you can predict microstates, what do your microstates look like? How do you characterize them? How do you say what the energy is and what and how transitions take place within different microstates? I think that's a valid question.
That I can see in my picture. So in my picture, the microstates appear because of the modes of graviton with Planckian momenta that would normally have Planckian frequency.
But they don't, because the particles coming out have much, much lower energy.
I'm talking about not physical, but I'm talking about spectrum. So the spectrum in our picture, what happens is that the spectrum of there are super soft modes that appear. We call them memory modes. And these super soft modes, they have frequency, which is given by 1/r of black hole radius times 1/n, where n is the entropy. So 1/r times 1/n, that's the frequencies of those memory modes that we get in our picture.
That's ultra low even compared to the Planck mass. No, I think the most particles in my case have energies and frequencies in the same order as the time of light of flight of a light of a photon in a black hole. Those are the Hawking particles.
The Hawking particles are different. So we distinguish two types of modes. So in our picture, black hole is made out of two types of modes. One we call master mode. The master mode is the main occupation number. These are Hawking modes that eventually fly out. So they have frequencies of 1/r, wavelengths 1/r. Then there are so-called memory modes. And memory modes, they come in large number of different flavors. And their gaps are 1 over r, 1 over n. So they are almost gone.
Now you deviate very, very strongly from Hawking's original picture. It was just Hawking particles coming out. You can throw in anything you like, you'll get Hawking particles out. That was his result. No memory particles or whatever you call them.
No, memory particles cannot come out on the Hawking timescale, but just by uncertainty principle. Look, their frequencies are 1 over r divided by 1 over s. That's an enormously slow frequency. So to excite a memory particle, you have to wait almost half decay time of a black hole. And that's also how it explains why you have to wait at least half of the black hole decay time to read out an information pattern which is stored in those memory modes. So everything matches.
Because all the information sits in those microstates and stays in those microstates. Yeah. So yes, you have all these microstates, they carry that energy, and the energy is released, or the information is released much later. That's fine.
That's exactly the point. Yes, that's what I'm saying. You need to wait up. You need to wait at least half emission time. So half of the black hole mass has to go out before you will be able to resolve these memory modes, the information hidden in the memory modes. So, and that's also very that is a consistent picture, because that's also why black hole memory modes have very low frequencies. So the information is stored in extremely low frequency modes, and those are the ones that can control the black hole microstates, and their frequencies are extremely low, as they should be.
Maybe Francesco can finish, and then Anupam. You were saying something.
No, first of all, can you hear me? Because Luca said that he doesn't hear me.
Now better, maybe.
Okay. It's just that I'm not sure I completely understood your question, your answer to my question of formation. Because, this could explain how you can form this object, but this would also mean that this object cannot be the endpoint of a gravitational collapse, like in an astrophysical black hole. I'm not talking about two particles colliding. I have one star, which is a classical object, like this is forming a trapping horizon. I cannot imagine how you form this type of object before forming the trapping horizon. This is what I don't understand.
But it does. So and
maybe this could be an extra object that you can observe in the universe, but I don't see how this could be could explain.
It's just an ordinary black hole caused by ordinary collapse. Yeah. But the collapse particles in this Pendle diagram, the collapsing particles are in the far past. Right? Well, for the outside observer, it's the far past. The far past for the outside observer is a very tiny region, narrow region across the past horizon. That region is so narrow that particles in there carry gigantic amounts of energy. In fact, the energy, according to a local observer, which is not the energy for the global, for the distant observer, but for the local observer, that energy grows exponentially. Therefore, no, so fast.
I want Minkowski in the past. I don't want this. I mean, I don't want a past horizon, because I want a star which is formed by, it's very diluted. I can approximate to Minkowski in the past.
Now, if you look carefully at the particles that went into the black hole long ago, it doesn't have to be the collapse. After the collapse, maybe some more particles.
Yeah, but the problem is that in this model, you do not have any particle entering into the black hole. So I can understand that you cannot have any information if you don't allow particles to go in. You know,
the dominant mode of the black hole is to emit particles in the Hawking spectrum, right? As Hawking particles. The Hawking particles are statistically the most abundant form of matter in which it can decay. So the black hole decays in Hawking particles because there are so many states that are Hawking states. And it's just Fermi's golden rule that then dictates that the black hole must decay mainly into Hawking particles. So now I just take time reversal. And I say that the formation process is a time reverse of the decay process. The formation process also I can use statistically as many states as I want, but the average state I'll choose will be just like the Hawking state for the evaporating black hole. This way, the picture becomes time reversal symmetric.
The problem is that maybe
as many possible in states as there are possible out states.
Yeah, maybe we have different background. This is why we don't probably understand each other. Because
I think it's true. You have to get used to this.
I mean, I like classical gravity, but and I want to describe what's going on. I see a black hole in astrophysics with a telescope.
You can use classical gravity to understand 99.9% of the adventures of a black hole. So most of the adventures of a black hole is that the black hole is some background in which you have a bunch of particles moving. And you see the particles that you threw in a minute ago, and the particle it causes to come out a minute after that. You don't see anymore the particles that went in very, very long ago. And the reason for that is that they get entangled in a very messy way with the particles that came in more recently. So the particles that came in more recently, they together form the entire set of microstates the black hole can be in. The black hole never looks at particles that went in long, long ago. So replacing them by Hawking particles makes no difference anymore, because it's the more recent incoming particles that should have a much bigger effect on the black hole microstates. And so I use those to describe how the black hole evolves from one step in time to the next. So I can do all these time steps. The only thing, the most difficult thing to handle here is exactly the question you've been asking. How did the whole thing get started? Well, the whole thing got started as a very, very tiny black hole, because when the horizon was opening up, the total surface of the horizon was very, very tiny. And that is, of course, Planckian physics that we then talk about. And that I don't have yet fully under control. That's because there you might have to use string theory or God knows what, theories that I don't understand, to show the transition. But then I can also say, wait a minute, that transition was a perfect quantum effect. I can use a quantum instanton to handle that situation. So in other words, the black hole formation process at the very, very first microseconds of its horizon being formed was a tunneling effect. A tunneling effect for which you can use an instanton to describe it. The black hole tunneled from vacuum to a state where something was happening. But the first moment, there were only very, very few particles that had entered the black hole. So the thing still had a very, very tiny horizon. and it was hardly visible because it was a very, very tiny excitation of the vacuum.
Okay, maybe Anupam.
Just to continue along this line, let's take Sun, solar mass black hole. Okay, it's a Schwarzschild radiation roughly around 3 kilometers or so. So what happens? So in your case, the system collapses, roughly comes around 3 kilometers or 1 kilometer, whatever distance is quite macroscopic. So you would say that there is some kind of like a wormhole connection happens between the two regions. Am I correct to understand your
point? The wormhole connects the two antipodes. So yeah. A point on one hemisphere is connected by a wormhole to a point at the other hemisphere. And the isopodes are the most direct connection. But it is this topological thing which I tried to explain with this piece of paper. That,
what is the wormhole stable in this case? You need something beyond. How will you keep this wormhole stable?
It's a background on which I do perturbative gravity. Now the perturbative gravitons never get a chance to change this metric very much. They are too weak for that.
I understand. So once
the more energetic particles, the more energetic particles, you have to realize that their information is being transmitted completely to the outgoing particles by the Shapiro shift effect. So these particles become zombies, so to speak, after they send out all their information to the outside world. They go into the forbidden region, but they have no information anymore. The information has been transmitted to the outgoing particles, and this way, the information being preserved in practice. But this happens at timescales short compared to the formation of the black hole, which happened very long ago. So very long ago, the black hole may have been very, very tiny, and there it got into existence by some quantum tunneling effect, which I find indeed very difficult to describe. But it was a hope that this picture will betray something, but not quite. In fact, Penrose had a similar picture of a black hole as well, that being formed and being decayed. But now these two points are to be identified. That's a bit difficult to imagine. So I should perhaps not show this picture. It's a bit confusing, but it gives you the impression that at the at a certain moment this thing opened up. There should be better ways to form it.
I kind of understand what you are saying. So essentially, you still have to assume that besides your GR, you would need some topological changing processes in the formation of a black hole. And this
the topological change is rather like a gauge transformation. It's not a physical change. It is a transformation from one set of coordinates to another set of coordinates. So the other set of coordinates is the coordinates you use in the eternal Penrose diagram. Originally, of course, we used just straight Minkowski coordinates before the black hole was formed. So a transition to other coordinates is one for practical reasons. In the new coordinates, the calculations converge much better. So let's make a transition from one coordinate frame to another coordinate frame. That's not a physical change, it's a mathematical change in the way we handle the situation as precisely as we can.
Then the space-time cannot be globally hyperbolic if you do that.
Okay.
You cannot have a global hyperbolic space-time and change topology. You cannot do that.
Each question, a lot more can happen than classically.
Please, Gara, we cannot hear Francesco if you speak together. Francesco, finish.
Sorry, maybe I have a problem with the microphone. No, what they say is that, I mean, to change topology, you cannot have a global hyperbolic space-time.
Classically, but quantum mechanically, you can do a lot more.
You can make a transition
from one coordinate frame to another coordinate frame.
But
to see that now, what was called quantum in one coordinate frame is called classical in the other coordinate frame. So originally, the black hole was formed by some quantum tunneling effect, which couldn't happen classically, but it can happen through quantum tunneling.
I agree, but these five objects that are not what LIGO sees.
I'm not talking about LIGO.
This is not the black hole that we see in our unit, the black holes. Black holes are formed by gravitational collapse. They are not formed by quantum effects and they grow. You have a star that collapse.
I'm using quantum description. So if you can stick to the classical description, but then after a while, you see very, very many head particles accumulating along the horizon. And you have to ask, what do they do to the particles coming out? Those are becoming quantum questions. Now, to answer those questions, you can better go to another coordinate frame. Coordinate frame doesn't say that classical things are replaced by classical coordinates here, and quantum things are replaced by quantum there. No, the whole classical and quantum thing together at one side is being transformed into a quantum and classical thing together at the other side. But the quantum effects get exchanged. So the classical argument that you can't change topology the way you say, which I'm not so sure whether that's actually correct, but let's assume it is, that of course doesn't happen as long as you stick to a classical calculation.
Sure, but I will
then continues to give the right answers for as long as it is valid. So the classical calculation, of course, does not give Hawking radiation. But I can assure you that those things that LIGO is seeing, they do emit Hawking particles.
Sure, but although,
that's unobservable.
Speak louder.
Sorry. So if I have a solar mass star which is collapsing, this is a macroscopic object. When you are at the collapse, you cannot say that you have a when you are very close to the collapse, you can still have a space-time which looks very close to Minkowski, which the topology cannot be the one of the wormhole. Then if you want to have your space-time, you need to change the topology, but in a macroscopic way. You cannot just change the Planck distance and then...
But what you can do instead is you make a transition to another set of coordinates. So you change your coordinates. You keep the thing physically the same. So physically, and indeed, as you say, where the horizon opens up, space and time are practically flat. Nothing of any interest seems to be happening. But you can count the possible number of states it can be in. And those states now will be energy eigenstates in general, but of course the total physical description of these states is very complex. It's fully quantum mechanical. But what you have to say is when the black hole is being formed, then now the thing can be, it sits in a different Hilbert space than where you had it before. In that Hilbert space, there are many other states which you didn't consider before the black hole is formed. So, and before, in fact, you were still looking at this locally flat region of the vacuum. Yes, so you thought you were seeing an horizon. But as soon as the black hole is formed, you say, now I'm going to a different coordinate frame to see what's going to happen next. So to find out what happens next, your original coordinates are no longer good enough, because these particles, they come out of the horizon. Where do these particles come from? Well, they came from excitations of this flat space that you were thinking you were seeing, but that flat space has vacuum fluctuations beyond the Planck scale. Normally, we ignore those and we can get away with it. But now you cannot anymore, because the black hole is going to emit those particles and you are interested in those particles. If you weren't interested, you can continue doing your classical calculation and reproduce the LIGO effects or whatever. But if you are interested, you want to observe those Hawking particles, then you are forced to go to other coordinate frames and to redo your calculation with these other coordinates where you understand the particles that come out of the black hole.
I will read your papers, because, yeah, okay.
Maybe Gia, and then maybe
the most. But the whole thing in my paper is I put the priorities different than what you asked me now. So okay. I can understand your worries, but if you forget those for a moment and you say, well, is the description of it evolution of a black hole over a short time interval, are those prescriptions valid? Do they make sense? I claim they make perfect sense. They make much better sense than what I've seen from other calculations. I still don't understand Zwie-Dwali's calculation well enough to say that they make sense to me. Right now, it doesn't, but that's because I don't understand what he's doing. So I don't understand what's happening locally in his calculation. I know exactly what happens locally in my calculation. It is just quantum mechanics on a curved background. That's all I'm doing.
Gia.
I was trying to, so one thing that a little bit is a little bit problematic in this conversation is that is the language, because we need to fix some, as I said many several times, right? We need to find some invariant statements and then maybe fix a framework around it and do some then develop these statements and stuff.
Well, my first question to you will always be, what are the energy eigenstates for the outside observer? Suppose that the outside observer sends in black particles and receives particles out of the black hole, but he puts a big wall around it. And so the outgoing particles are being reflected back in at that wall. But we are totally right. Under control of that wall. That wall is just a classical thing that we often do in statistical physics. We put a big wall around we put the thing in a vessel. That shouldn't change the physics at the boundary of the vessel. But it allows us to consider energy eigenstates. So the energy eigenstates have ingoing waves and outgoing wave, and they all are stationary energy waves. And now the question is, what are those states? How do you characterize those states?
In my picture.
Do you understand my question?
Yeah, sure. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I was not commenting specifically about my picture, but yes. So in my picture, black hole has two types of frequencies. Okay, these are two major types of frequencies. One are frequencies of the Hawking quanta, and then these are soft modes. And then there's a second class of frequencies, which is super soft. Those have frequencies that are inverse of the half decay time of a black hole. So in my picture, I as a quantum description, black hole has these two types of constituents with very different frequencies. Now, the first time of constituents, they are the material out of which black hole is built. So you have many, many high occupation number of those modes, okay, of soft Hawking type modes. Approximately there, so of order the entropy, it comes out. This is not an input, it comes out. And then there is a second layer of modes, these memory modes, which are super soft, and they come in enormous different variety, the same variety as the number of momentum eigenstates of a Planck mass momentum, would be Planck mass momentum eigenstates, but they are super soft. So black hole is made out of.
Yes, you can say that, but.
Maybe Gia is not
yes, he is frozen, I think.
Maybe Gia is not around, he got frozen.
Yes, he is frozen. Oh,
okay, oh, okay.
He's back.
If you look at the energy eigenmodes, you are first interested in the big separations between all energy levels, and later only interested in the microstructure of these energy levels. So when you talk about very low frequency modes, then they will contribute very little to the energy eigenmodes. Would you agree?
Sorry, I was kicked out of the Zoom, probably. Can you hear me now?
Yes,
I can hear you, yes.
Right. No, what I said that, okay, in my picture, there are these two types of modes. One is the constituents that are the building material of a black hole, and then the other ones which keep the memory, but they are extremely cheap energetically because they have very low frequencies. Now, if you are an outside observer, you want to send a wave into a black hole, you have to, and you want to, if you want to excite the super soft modes, just by uncertainty principle, you would expect that normally. You have to wait very long. So therefore, it's not practical to excite those modes unless you want to wait the time scale, which is of order of black hole half emission time. But so that's why,
Would you agree that long time scale effects should all be embedded or included in the short time scale effect? So you have a short time scale where things happen. And of course you can then just sit there and wait to see what the thing does.
No, I don't agree with that.
Long time scale effects. So think of a very slow chemical reaction taking place in a gas. You have a gas, you have these atoms moving very fast, but the chemical reaction is very, very slow, but makes a big shift, big change at long time scales. So now you have two time scales. That's fine, but still, you want to understand that chemical reaction I just talked about. You also want to understand that at the micro level, what does it come from? How did it enter into my calculation? And what kind of physical effects am I talking to about at locally at small time scales and small distance scales? Or is your theory normal or what?
Yeah, well, that's precisely what I'm trying to say that in my picture. So if you see, again, I want to reiterate this. There are certain questions that we cannot even be posed unless we have certain microscopic model. This microscopic model may be wrong or may be right. That's a different story. But in order to discuss, we need a certain microscopic model. Then we can say whether this model is wrong or right. Right. So what I'm saying is that—
I don't understand your microscopic model, so yes.
Well, since you asked, I answered about two frequencies. I can give a separate seminar about the microscopic model, but I'm saying, so my microscopic model, it has these two frequencies, but what I'm saying is that I'm working in a theory of an S-matrix, and in theory of S-matrix, I understand what I'm describing. I'm saying, I'm working in a theory in which I can limit, if a black hole is large, I can limit myself with Einstein gravity. I don't need to enter into UV completion. I can limit myself with interactions of graviton with itself. And these interactions of graviton, they are fully sufficient to describe, at least in living order, process of black hole formation, and also to tell me how the information is stored, et cetera, et cetera. What I'm missing is that I don't see what is the framework in which you are discussing, because you said you don't want to use S-matrix picture. But that's at the same time,
I've asked the same question to you that I understand my model and my calculation. I don't understand yours.
No, it's not a question of understanding technicalities of the calculation. I'm not saying that you should understand all the technicalities of my calculation in this 10-minute conversation, but my point was, you were saying that S matrix is not somehow
but the primary thing the S-matrix is fine, but the primary thing is first understand your local interactions, then compute your S-matrix. And locally, of course, you don't see an S-matrix, you only see it after.
So you want to do, you want to do physics. Yeah, I understand, that you want to do physics on a curved background. You want to do physics or a curved background on very short time scales.
That's exactly.
Now, okay, so now from what I see from my picture, this doing this in my picture corresponds to n going to infinity and t short. And
what is it?
I see that n is the occupation number, which is the same as the mass of the black hole or the entropy of a black hole. Because when I'm treating, when you are treating a background as a local classical curved background, you say curved background is a classical notion. This means that you are treating your background classical, you are not resolving your background. So you are doing quantum mechanics on top of you are doing quantum mechanics on top of classical background. That in my picture corresponds to a rigid limit. That limit is accounted in my picture. It corresponds to the limit in which I'm taking occupation number of gravitons in the black hole infinite. And so one over n effects that would back react on the geometry are very small. But then I'm telling you, if I do that in my picture, I will get to nowhere. If I do that in my picture, I would not see any physics of a black hole. All the physics would become hidden because all the physics about information storage is one over n physics. And so
There is information that comes in much earlier and is being processed much quicker than I think your one over n effect. Because the ingoing particles and outgoing, I'm doing soft particles on a background. So at first approximation, these things do nothing, right? They just interact weakly with each other and you can ignore the interactions and get away with it.
No, that's okay, but then you're doing a different problem. You're facing a different problem.
There's a very elementary effect that you shouldn't forget, which is that the ingoing particles interact with the outgoing particles gravitationally. And that gravitation cannot be ignored.
And I fully accept your computation. I fully admire that computation. I'm just saying that that computation. So if you are telling me that you will do a computation on short time scales on a fixed classical background, I am telling you from my picture, my answer would be that that computation will never tell you anything about how black hole stores information. Never.
Oh yes, no, because you do. That's the whole point. Okay, so then you haven't understood the gravitational back reaction. I can take the ingoing particle and find that it leaves so much information on the outgoing particles that it's becoming a zombie. You have to ignore it when it goes on. I have grabbed all the information in terms of the outgoing particles.
That's a different information. That's a different type of information.
It's the same. It's a unitary transformation. The Fourier transform is a unitary procedure.
No, I understand. This computation can be useful to understand for understanding. I have a given black hole, which has already been formed. And now, what is the mechanism of adding information to this black hole? How the information is locally processed? But sure, that's perfectly fine problem, but that's a different problem. I'm saying that's a different problem. That's not a problem that answers how the information that was embedded into a black hole during the formation.
It transports all the information. So
but you already have a
provided that. Provided that you put the information in the form of a momentum distribution. And that is, there you can criticize.
Your black hole is already there, right? To start with, you already have a black hole in your case. In your case, you already have a classical black hole.
I have a black hole, which could be very small or very big, and it may grow or shrink. That part you can.
So you want to feed it. You want to feed this black hole and make it grow.
Oh yeah, yes. If you feel it.
Then you are looking at a different problem. So you want to grow. You want to make a black hole grow gradually.
Yeah. Yes. But all.
That's the problem you're looking at. Okay. Sorry. Then maybe it's okay. Yeah. Maybe you're right.
The long scale effect. Maybe that's the same thing you talk about. The black hole can grow.
Maybe you can capture something like that. Yes. Then I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. What worries me? My potential worry would be that what worries me is that you are treating background as classical. That's what worries me.
Well, it's only classical over a short amount of time. But then when, as soon as you say, this particle has come so close to the black hole, I can't see it anymore. from that moment on, it is part of the black hole. So the black hole has become heavier for that reason. If that particle is carrying energy, the whole thing will be more massive than it was before. And that accumulates.
Okay, maybe that way, yeah, okay.
And so the black hole becomes
maybe in that way, maybe in that way you can get somewhere with that thing. Yeah, maybe.
Absolutely.
Yeah, maybe in that way. I don't see, but by the way, I don't see how, because I would be still worried, because my understanding would be that unless we resolve the classical, because if I give you, for example, gravitational wave, if you treat gravitational wave classically, you will never understand its quantum structure. But you, in order to understand quantum structure of the gravitational wave, you have to resolve it as a coherent state of gravitons.
By linearizing Einstein's theory, and putting low energy particles on top of this wave of the classical particle, and they will have the effect of enhancing or reducing that wave. So I think that you would do it in any branch of physics. You would split your problem to a classical part and a quantum mechanical part. The classical part is artificial because really, strictly speaking, everything is quantum mechanical and you shouldn't make it. But for practical reasons, often you do.
Okay, okay, maybe that somehow could, maybe this somehow explain. So basically,
I think we should.
To understand quantum physics of gravitational wave.
Yeah. Can you repeat the information lost due to bad connection?
Can you hear me now? So for example, if we would do something simpler with your method, so suppose I would try to understand quantum physics of a gravitational wave, of a classical gravitational wave, with your method. Just a gravitational wave. So you have gravitational wave interacting with quantum particles. And now I give you classical gravitational wave and you want to understand quantum effect of gravitational wave. So in my language, I would resolve it as a coherent state of graviton.
I would not object against, of course.
But you said that you have a method in which you can do better without doing that.
No, my method should not apply directly to gravitational waves. It's really constrained for black holes because I'm particularly focusing on this topology change. You see, this topology, the topological effect is really something. And many people ask questions here, which I think are quite legitimate questions. Don't get me wrong. So these questions are legitimate. You know, how do I understand this? How do I understand that? But I'm first arriving at the big lines, and the big lines are that you have to identify the opposite domains of the black hole.
So you are saying something important now. You are saying that your method would not be applicable to quantumly resolve other classical backgrounds, for example, gravitational waves.
I think I would have nothing to add to existing methods, probably including yours. So that would not change. And where these topological things become important is precisely the formation and decay.
So for you, topology is important. Okay.
And I think it is so important, it might change everything we understand about gravity, ultimately, because space and time themselves might be transformed into a foam. You have space, you know, the same time, space-time foam story, that you no longer have a continuum, but you have something discrete with big bubbles and little bubbles. All these form, black holes forming and decaying cause a bubble in space-time. So if you make a space-time full of bubbles, you get foam. Something like this might be happening. If so, I would like to know about it. But then the black holes play a much more central role than they normally are given by most people as being some sort of peculiarity of string theory. That's not what they are. They are a very elementary component of general relativity, which plays a role all by itself in what you call the quantum theory of gravity. I could call it the quantum theory of black holes, which changes everything. Well, it changes the sequence of priorities that we impose on our theories. So I'm advancing the idea that maybe the black hole comes first and then try to quantize gravity. And that's not the normal, the order that people normally think about these things.
Yeah, that's different, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I think...
Sorry, I think too much of the time.
Sorry?
I think we found common grounds. That is very important.
I think at least you understood better each other, maybe.
Right.
Yeah. Not common grounds.
Yeah. Is
there at least some common grounds exist, right? Although there are separated islands. Yeah. Islands of information.
Yeah. I can just say that that these ideas are very exciting. Once you do this calculation, once you discover things are hanging together in an interesting way, then you might be carried away like I am with this theory. Most people feel themselves carried away by string theory. I personally think this theory is much better than string theory. It could be related because the fact that momentum is the primary source of that you need to describe for in and outgoing particles, that's just the same as string theory. In string theory, you put in and outgoing particles as vertex insertions on the string worldsheet. I'm using the same math practically, but instead of a string worldsheet, I use the horizon of a black hole. But the rest looks just like string theory. So I find that fascinating. It may be that string theory is the right theory, but with the wrong words. So that eventually you might have to say it's not strings you're talking about, it's black hole horizons we are talking about, but we're using the same mathematics. It hasn't happened, by the way. This is not yet the way it comes out, but maybe some future developments might be saying something like this, that we are much closer to string theory with black holes to string theory than we thought. I thought I was doing something else, but it turned out to be doing the same thing.
Okay, so we are beyond the planned time. So we are now is 5:15 in Europe. Yeah.
And thanks. Thank you very much for a very interesting discussion. I find it very interesting, although a lot of things I'm not still understanding, but I will definitely read Herard papers and also Diwali's papers more clearly to understand connection between them. Yeah.
Actually, we had 1 hour black hole discussion, which was not planned. So now it was good. Yeah. I mean.
Okay. Yeah,
so, yeah. Yeah, I think now we can really say goodbye for a while. And
thank you very much for giving us this opportunity to discuss again.
That was very nice.
Fighting with G before, but it's all right.
Yeah. I don't know if you have a glass of wine or something. We can make a toast, maybe. Even whatever.
Well, I don't have it.
Some coffee, maybe.
Okay, I will make it with you for you then.
Okay.
So, yeah, you can imagine.
Okay. But I'll see you again sometime.
Right, but Gerald, I mean, this to be continued.
Yeah, sure, of course. Okay.
You will not get so easily away with this.
Let's say due to time constraint, we need to stop it.
Maybe you can give me a good advice to where I can find your way of arguing.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I'll send you reference. Yeah.
Please do.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So thank you very much, everyone. Have a nice day.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks for my discussion.
Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye.